watch cartoons, which is a pretty great goal for a talk. I mean, I think it is. But before I get to talking about cartoons, I need to talk about why I'm going to talk about cartoons. So you're going to talk about me for a little while, but it's okay. I'm going to try to keep that brief so we can get to the cartoons. But here's the thing. I never expected to end up where I am now. And I don't necessarily mean like right here now, although kind of at the same time. I never set out to be a speaker. I've been doing this for 5 years and I really just stumbled into it. But it's kind of the same thing with everything else in my job. I've done a variety of roles throughout my quote-unquote career. I've been a web designer. Here's a pretty picture look at why I talk about me. I've been a web developer. I somehow ended up becoming an educator. Right now I work as a curriculum director. I have little to no formal training in any of those things, and yet somehow I ended up doing them. My point about all this is that, there's a few reasons of how that came to me. I don't know if other of you who have knocked around the tech industry for a few years, you may have had the same experience when there's, you know, the young, fresh-faced innocents will come up when they want to be in the industry and ask me, like, how did you get to where you are? And inevitably, I personally always deeply disappoint them because I have no idea how I ended up here. It's just been a series of accidents, and somehow this is where I am. Part of that, the reason of that is because when I was younger and I was doing all of the thinking about what I want to be when I grow up, the tech industry, especially as it is now, did not really exist. I'm a little bit older than I look. So, you know, I'm still old enough to have grown up at a time when I didn't have the internet when I was a teenager, which, if you've seen my daughter, who's a teenager over the corner there, cannot fathom this at all. It blows her mind. She's like, what did she do? I'm like, I don't know. But somehow, we did it. But here's the thing. So when I was a teenager and I was thinking about what I wanted to be when I grew up, what actually I wanted to be was an animator. I wanted to animate cartoons. It was the 90s. It was a good time for that. Disney was having a renaissance. Animaniacs was on television. It was good. Good times for cartoons and animation, and that's what I wanted to be. I didn't become an animator. We covered that part already. I don't really have good reasons for that, necessarily. It didn't happen, you know? And it made me kind of sad. It still does to a certain extent. But recently, I've been thinking about the fact of spending all that time thinking about this other career path that I never had, and thinking about the career path that I ended up having, and how all those things fit together and they merge, and, you know, what I wanted to do and what I want to do in the future, and all, like, you know, super easy stuff like that. I've been thinking about a lot of this stuff. But it led me back to some stuff that I did think about and learn when I was younger, when I was focused on a different path. And I realized that it actually did apply, even though it was in a different realm, or it was when I was focused on a different goal. There was a lot of things that I learned from my interest in animation that I have applied to my jobs without even realizing it, and that I can continue to apply to that. And there's a lot of interesting stories that have become more and more relevant to me as I've gone on, even though I've never done anything in animation. So I'm going to tell you some of those stories, you know, through it. The thing is, they all come from pretty much one person, and that is the animator Chuck Jones. Does anybody here know who Chuck Jones is? Okay, a few people. Here's the thing about Chuck Jones is that even if you don't know who he is, you know who he is, or at least you know what he did, basically. So Chuck Jones was an animator in Warner Brothers Studios in the 30s, 40s, and 50s, and 60s. He was there for a long time. He's one of the people who created Bugs Bunny. He also created The Roadrunner and Coyote and a lot of other stuff. Like I said, you've seen Chuck Jones' work even if you don't know who he is. He also wrote a couple of biographies. Well, they're biographies/biographies, and then also kind of like creativity instruction manuals. They're really, really well written. And I read them when I was younger, and again, it was one of those things that I didn't realize how much that really like seeped into my understanding of how I interacted with the world and how I created things in whatever realm that is. I'm going to tell you some of my favorite stories from his books. And, you know, in light of what I got out of them, but also hopefully in light of what you can get out of them. So the first thing lesson I pulled out of this is this idea of starting anywhere and sticking with it. So Chuck Jones was born around the turn of last century. There were no animation schools when he was studying in the 1920s, I think kind of going into the 30s. So he went to a typical art school, and he tells a story about the very first class he walked into in his art school, his first drawing class. The professor said, "All of you have 100,000 bad drawings in you. So the sooner you get rid of them, the better it's going to be for everyone." And this was, I've carried this around with me for years. I love it. It's so useful. I use it for myself. I use it when I taught classes. Because it doesn't have to be drawings. It's anything, right? But what a great way to start an educational path by saying, look, you're going to screw up a lot. Over and over and over again. In fact, into the thousands. And that's totally cool. In fact, not only is it cool, you have to do that to get to the next level. It's a really great way of just, you know, leveling the playing field, saying you don't have to come in here at a certain level already. You don't have to be an expert in this. This is a journey. You're going to have to take it. Just, I mean, basically deal with it, but in a really encouraging way. So I really like this quote. This is one of the things that Chuck Jones always pointed to in terms of how he learned to work through the necessary parts that were sometimes kind of tedious of creativity and bringing a project to completion. And he has another story about that. So as I said, he grew up in the very early part of the 1900s. He grew up in Southern California, so he had this really amazing advantage that he didn't know at the time, where he could go down the street and watch Charlie Chaplin make movies. And he said one day, when he was a little boy, his father came home and like blew his mind by saying that he had been watching Charlie Chaplin filming a certain scene, and he kept not getting it right. And this is the quote. I'm going to be having a lot of quotes in here, but I'm going to read them. I'm going to use his words whenever I can, so if you want to come back and visit him later, feel free to do that. But I'm going to make sure I read them all, too. So Chuck said, "One evening I lost faith in both my father and Chaplin when my father came home to tell us that he had seen Chaplin shoot a single 15-second scene 132 times." And I think he goes on a little bit more in the book, and he talks about it was a certain just kind of like running around the scene, and he's like supposed to fall, but he wasn't falling the way he wanted to fall, and so he did it again 131 times over and over and over again. And little Chuck is like, why not do it right in the first place? Can't even learn to do it while watching his own movies. But then he goes on to say, he said, "It was the beginning of my understanding of the two primary rules of all creativity. The first is that you must love what you are doing. The second is that you must be willing to do the often dull and tiring work necessary to bring each creative endeavor to completion. And in that endeavor, only the love should show." There's a little bit more in this passage too, where he talks about you watch Chaplin's movies, you don't see the 131 times that he fell or that he didn't do it right. You see the time he got it right, but it's not chance. He got to that point by those 131 other takes that he did. So this is a little bit of an extension of the first lesson, is that, but it reinforces the same point. It's really hard to make things, and it's really hard to learn how to do things the way you want them to be done. And there's no way through it, or there's no way around it, but just going right through it and doing all of that work. And it's gonna maybe suck in the meantime, but that's okay, because you'll get there. All right, sorry, I'm gonna have too much. So to kind of wrap up this particular point, this particular story, is going back to Chuck Jones' experience when he was learning at school, at art school. And he said that he had, and I think it might have been the same instructor that I quoted in the beginning, I'm not sure, it might have been another one. But he talked about this instructor had two critiques. So if you were there in class and you were drawing, and this instructor came up behind you, there were two things he would say. One of them would be, "Looks like you're having some trouble," which would mean that, yeah, I think maybe things weren't going as well as they should be or that you wanted to, so he would help you work through that. But he said that the other critique, not so much a critique as an observation, would be, "Having fun?" And he said, having fun was the best thing that you could get from this instructor. That meant he could see that you were enjoying the process of what you were doing. This always really struck with me, because while the other two things are talking about reaching a particular goal or getting to a point, this makes the point in itself that it's not always about having a goal. That maybe the goal is that you're enjoying the process, and that's all the goal that you need to have, and maybe that's okay too. I think sometimes it's really easy to get locked into, I need to get to this certain point, or I need to be at this level of expertise, I need to have this completed, I need to do this, and forgetting, you know, maybe the process itself is valuable as well. Maybe that's enjoyable. Maybe you don't have a particular goal in what you're doing, but you're going to do it anyway. So those three things together are how I learned a lot about process in many things, whether it was in my career. It's definitely something that I've talked about when I've taught code-related things. All of these things, the fact that you're going to have to do a lot of work to get where you want to go. When I was a coding instructor in my last job, one of our mantras was, you are not your code, which means that, you know, this is a separate thing from you. And so if somebody's critiquing that, it's not a reflection on you as a person. And these things have that same message to me, that this is a process that you need to go through. And it's not about anything that you're doing wrong. It's about what we're going through. And then also, maybe we should be valuing that process as we're learning. Even if it's, you know, not perfect, doesn't have to be. Maybe it's just about us enjoying what we're doing. Another thing that I really picked up from Chuck Jones is this idea of valuing individuality and character. Has anybody seen this cartoon? This is from, can you see it okay? It's Mark Anthony, and who's the big bulldog, and he has his little kitty. If you have not seen this, I think there's a couple of them. The first one is called Feed the Kitty. You should go look it up. I think it's online a couple places. It's a really beautiful little cartoon about the bulldog, who's this big ferocious bulldog. He comes across this little kitten, and he starts barking ferociously, and the kitten just kisses him on the nose, and then climbs on his back and goes to sleep, and it melts his heart completely. The problem is that the bulldog's, his owner, has told him that he's not allowed to bring anything else in the house, or he's going to get in so much trouble. So he can't let her know that he has this little kitten that he's now fallen in love with. So he spends the whole cartoon hiding the kitten, and of course hijinks ensue and all of that. It's really remarkable to me because this is a cartoon about the two main characters are animals who never speak. This is not like a other cartoons where they speak English. They never speak at all. The only person who speaks is the dog's owner, and that's only briefly. I've seen people cry at this cartoon, and I see people, I mean me too. Like, it's so, I don't know, it really gets to something. But just the fact of that, the fact that we can have a 6-minute cartoon about characters that don't even speak, and yet we can get so much out of it that we can connect with it on that level. That in itself led into another really important lesson for me. In this passage, Chuck is talking specifically about animation and how you would draw characters. He says specifically, we are not what we look like, we're not even what we sound like. We are how we move, in other words, our personalities. And our personalities are shaped by what we think, where we come from, by what we have experienced. And that personality is unique to each of us. Even though you may not be drawing characters or having to think about how you would animate a character, there's a lot in here that speaks to how we interact with people and connect with people and empathize with people. Because this is true. Everybody is really unique, and they're bringing with them all these this background information, all these experiences that you may not be aware of. And so if we can find ways to think about that, what other people are bringing in, and think about what we're bringing with ourselves and how people are seeing that. I think that this is really, you know, for lack of a better term, we talk about some of this stuff in relationship with diversity and inclusion in our industry, which I think makes a lot of sense. It's all about learning empathy, and it's about learning how to bring in these, understand the other people's backgrounds and have communications based around it. I've always figured that if we can respond the way that we respond to a cartoon about a bulldog and his little kitten that never speak to us, we should be able to find ways of communicating with other people and finding these common grounds and understanding other people's backgrounds and getting something just as valuable out of that. And that if we learn how to do that, then we get to mine all of the rich experiences that unique individuals bring to what we're doing, our workplaces and our communities and everything that we're making. If we can learn to communicate effectively and find these common ground, then we just have so much more to work with, even if we're not bulldogs or kittens, which is the ideal, but we can't always get there. So here's another idea, respecting your medium. This is a really straightforward, practical lesson that I've learned. And this goes back to a story that Chuck Jones told, again, when he was a young boy. When he was younger, his father tried a lot of get-rich-quick schemes that almost inevitably failed. There was always be like some new idea, some big build-up, and then the business would fail. The thing is that in part of the build-up, what his father would do would buy a whole bunch of new stationery with a new business letterhead on it, and a whole bunch of new pencils with a business name on it. So when the business failed, all of the Jones kids got the best drawing materials and imaginable. They got to use these great materials. The thing is, but their father wanted to make sure he got rid of this stuff so he could get on to the next business. So he would encourage the kids to use as much as they can. And they also said they were actually forbidden to draw on both sides of the paper. He says, no, you're only allowed to draw on one side. And he said, what if you were Leonardo da Vinci and you painted the Mona Lisa on one side of the canvas and the Last Supper on the other? Like, how would you ever paint it? And then Chuck goes on to say, he said, nevertheless, and perhaps, just perhaps, he knew what he was saying, he brought into focus the most vital rule of creativity. You must, if you ever pretend to artistry, respect your medium, be it a blank piece of paper or a canvas, an untouched bar sheet, an uncarved piece of stone, or an unexposed frame of film, or an exposed frame of film. So this was, when he was writing this was still really early to connect directly to what we do in the tech industry today. For me, this always made a lot of sense, though. A lot of my speaking career I've spent talking about the connection between design and development, and talking about what it's like to work or design for a medium that is dynamic and moving. And what that means in terms of usability and things of that nature. So this makes a lot of sense to me. In fact, this is one of the passages that correlates most directly to what I've done in my career on a daily basis. But it's very easy to translate it to pretty much anything you do. You understand the rules of what you're working with. And the more you can understand that, whether or not you think that's your exact realm, the more you can understand the whole, the better you're going to be able to make something effective with this. Going back to my earlier example, so if you were maybe a developer who thinks that you don't know anything about design or don't understand the whole process or don't need to, my argument would be in light of this is that the more you understand about the whole and understand what you're working with, the better products we can make. And also vice versa when it comes to disciplines. So the next lesson I pulled out is the idea of finding inspiration and constraint. In Warner Brothers Studios in the 1940s, in that era when they were making cartoons. So here's the thing about those cartoons. We know a lot of them today because they're on television, they're rerun a lot, right? I used to watch them on Saturday mornings. We have them on DVDs now. But when they made them, nobody expected them to ever be watched again beyond the one time they were shown in the theater. And they were really produced with the sense of, back in those days, if you were a theater owner, you would order a package from a movie studio. It means you got a feature movie, you got a newsreel, and you got a cartoon. It all fit into a nice time slot, and they just needed the cartoon to round everything out. Other than that, nobody cared. The Warner Brothers Studios in those days were, the animation studios, were just an amazing bit of, we don't care about what we're producing, we just need a product to fit in this slot. Chuck Jones in his book tells some very colorful stories about how they produce things in those circumstances. But the thing that always stuck out to me when I read these books is the interesting thing that when they made cartoons, these bits of film, they were not allowed to edit at all, period. There was no editing. And if you know anything about film, that sounds ridiculous, and it is. All of the cartoons had to be 6 minutes long, and so they had to plan it out to the second before they made any of it. Because there was no time to edit, there was no money, nobody cared. Like, the producers are like, we need 6 minutes of this, I don't care what's in it, produce me 6 minutes. And so, as a director, Chuck Jones had to think of every single second of an animated cartoon, all the frames, all the music, how everything went together ahead of time. And he said later is that none of them realized that there were any other way of doing it. None of them realized that editing was a thing that existed. They just knew that this is what they had to do. But the thing is, you watch those films now, those cartoons, and their timing is impeccable. Everything is, the storytelling is impeccable, because it had to be. So there's a really strong lesson in that for me, is that they were able to distill everything down to what it absolutely had to be. And this is something Chuck said, that, no, I don't know if he's specifically talking about this, but I drew the inference, but he said the whole essence of good drawing and of good thinking, perhaps, is to work a subject down to the simplest form possible and still have it believable for what it's meant to be. A lot of times I think that our inclination is to fight against constraints. Nobody, we don't want to be constrained, especially us. Like, no, we don't want to do things we don't want to do. Like, we've got freedom, we have power, we get to make things with a client or anything else puts constraints on us that makes us do things in a way that we would not reach for in the beginning, that makes us just not like things at all. And I'm the same way. But that's why I try to keep this in mind, because I think that sometimes constraints can create some really interesting things, because they'll force you to think more carefully about what you're doing and why. So it's not necessarily always a good thing to have constraints imposed on you, but it doesn't necessarily always have to be a bad thing either. I think it's worth going through that process of thinking about maybe this is an opportunity for us to really distill the essence of what we're doing down to what it has to be. Take away unnecessary things, maybe find better ways of doing what we're making or trying to achieve that we wouldn't otherwise come across. How many of you have seen the cartoons that these slides are from? Somebody's very excited about that. That makes me happy. All right, we'll get back to the goal of having you see cartoons after this. The last lesson is really a culmination of all the others. It's everything that I pulled together in terms of why these things mean a lot to me. And I start this section off with another story that Chuck told. This one is a little bit different. I'm going to have to draw it out a little bit more. But Chuck Jones, like I said, was animating 30s, 40s. This is also the time that Disney was doing a lot of really influential stuff in terms of their shorts. They started doing feature animation, the first studio to ever make a feature-length animated film, that sort of thing was going on. And Chuck Jones obviously saw that this was really impressive. Wow, nobody's been doing this before. So he sent a letter to Walt Disney about that and was like, this is really cool, like, thank you. And Walt Disney wrote a letter back to him. And he was like, wow, he was really proud of that letter, and he carried it around for years just so he could show everybody. He said that over the years, he wrote Walt Disney another 4 or 5 letters, and every single time he wrote a letter to him, Walt Disney wrote him a letter back. And it got to a point in the early 60s, Chuck said that he ended up just being at a place that was across the street from the hospital where Walt was. Nobody really knew it at the time, but it was really close to Walt's death. And so Chuck went in to visit him, and he introduced himself, and he said, thank you for answering every letter I ever sent to you. And then he said, Walt Disney said something really strange to him. He said, it wasn't hard. He said, you were the only animator who ever wrote to me. And Chuck tells the story, obviously with some sadness, of kind of like, wow, this guy who changed the whole industry and the whole business of animation was able to reply to all the letters that I wrote to him because no animator ever wrote to him to talk about this sort of thing. To me, the story sticks in my mind for a lot of different reasons. It reminds me to always, be appreciative of when people reach out to me, or that I should reach out to people that I admire and do that. But it also makes me think of just what kind of connections we're forging in our community in general. I feel like I know that in my own career, and I see it sometimes in others, that it's really easy to get so heads down in what we're doing, or this particular thing that we're learning, whatever it is, it's really easy to kind of get buried in it and forget to look up and see what else is around us. Sometimes we forget to talk to other people, not you guys because you're here at the conference, right? But I do it in my daily job, or even maybe you'll get stuck in going to the same type of conferences, or you see the same people and you forget to talk about new things, or you're not reaching out to see something new or learn something new. I see this as an example of forgetting what else is out there and what other input that we can bring into ourselves and our lives and our work. Remember to talk to somebody about something new, maybe somebody you never talked to before. Maybe it's at work, or it's not at work, or it's in a community or somewhere else. There's so many things out there, and I think this also goes to when we're thinking about education in general. All of these things here are things that I picked up years ago when I was a teenager, and I was reading these books, and I was thinking about this goal that I was trying to work towards, and I never got there. I'm not an animator today. And it's a little funny that back when I was wanting to be an animator, the jobs that I'm doing now didn't exist, and now that I'm here doing these jobs, traditional hand-drawn animation doesn't really exist anymore. So it's kind of switched, and couldn't have foreseen that. But I got a lot out of this different discipline. I learned a lot about how to think about the world, how to connect with the world, how to be open to new ideas, how to be open to learning new things and experimenting with things, and being okay with the whole process of experimenting and creating things without knowing exactly where it was going to end up. If I had never gone down that path, and if I had actually succeeded in that path, I may not have learned all this stuff. So it's the fact that I actually kind of failed in that and focused on something completely different than what I ended up doing that I ended up coming around full circle and learning all this stuff. And so there's a lot to me in terms of just being open and staying open and making sure that you're reaching out to everything that you possibly can, whether you think it's going to fit into your path and your goal right now, or whether it seems relevant or not, or whether you think that person is actually going to talk back to you or anything like that, reach out anyway. As Chuck says, the rules are simple. Take your work, but never yourself, seriously. Pour in the love and whatever skill you have, and it will come out. And I don't necessarily say this, it doesn't have to be your job. If you have a job that's just a job, that's okay too. But whatever it is that you want to try, has anybody had like an old hobby that you don't do anymore, and every once in a while you think about like, hey, I should do that again? I'm not good at that anymore, so there's no point. Or something like that. It doesn't matter. Do it anyway. That's an order. It's not about, you know, your skill or anything like that. This can be anything in your life. It could be relationships with people. It could be, you know, anything. It could be your job if that's what you want it to be. Chances are there's something there that you feel passionately about, and it's really great to remind yourself that that's all that really matters. And just go try it. Just go try something new, or try something that you used to do that you don't do anymore, or that you would always wanted to do and you thought you couldn't do. Some things like that. So I said earlier that my goal was to get you all to want to go watch cartoons, which is true. Does anybody want to go watch cartoons now? Maybe? Okay. And we achieved that. But really my goal was to want to make you all go do something new. And I know that's a really big, vague, grandiose goal, but that's what I wanted to do anyway, because why not? What's stopping you? It doesn't matter if it fits into your plan, because, I mean, what are plans anyway? You're going to get something out of it no matter what. And somehow in the end, if you go out and do something sincerely, it's going to work out and it all comes back around the way it should be. And that's really all I have, so, you know, Godspeed. Straight biography. The second has a little bit more about like technical drawing. Even if you're not interested in drawing at all, you'll still get a lot out of that one too. So I recommend you go look that up. And I wrote a blog post essentially. That's where this talk came from. It goes into a lot more detail about some of those things. So it's on my website and my archive. If you'd like to check that out, feel free. I ended a little bit early. Do we want to chat about some things? If anybody has anything they want to ask or chat about, I'd be happy to do that for a few minutes. We're all tired. It's been so much stuff. All right, thank you.